Everyone loves happy hour, and no one makes an hour happier than actress, comedian, author, host, and self-proclaimed hat girl, Dee Dee Sorvino, who each show serves up an hour of good times and great conversation. Food, culture, fashion, current events, history, or just good gossip. Grab a cocktail and take a seat as Dee Dee shares stories, talks with friends, and makes you wish you could keep the bar tab open all night. Where there's a party, there's Dee Dee, and you are invited. Sit back, relax, and enjoy Drinks with Dee Dee. Here's your host, Dee Dee Sorvino.
Hello and welcome, everyone. I am Dee Dee Sorvino, your host of Drinks with Dee Dee, and we've got the gang, we've got the bar together. It's a very exciting show, and I'm so, so happy to have Matthew Socey back. And Matthew, we missed you. We know you're busy.
It's
you're
nice to meet
you. You're a big film critic. You have your own show on PBS. You have all the stuff going on. And what is the name of your show? And just tell us what you've been up to.
Well, it's called Film Sociology. That's S-O-C-E-Y.
And where do we find that?
It's your name, but it's a different word.
Oh my gosh, Michael. I'm so glad you got that after a year. After well over a year, you finally got that.
Better late than never.
Yeah, it's on. God.
The show is posted on Fridays at WFYI.org. And we do everything from, what was it? Last week, I didn't review Guardians of the Galaxy, but I reviewed three Bob Hope films because that's the unpredictability that the program gives you. We talk about what you guys have been watching lately. And of course, I make reference to y'all, especially with this week's topic. So, but the other part is I am currently portraying the voice of the book in Footlight Musical's production of How to Succeed in Business Without Really Trying.
And fabulous.
If you don't know that, for lack of a better comparison, it's Mad Men the Musical. And the
with Harry Potter.
The revival did have Harry Potter. Very good.
But I really thought you were off again, Michael. Sorry, my apologies.
No,
I thought you're like, what are you talking about?
I can see why.
He's on a hot streak. So, but no, the original musical and film is what made Robert Morris a star. And that's why it was great casting when Robert Morris got cast as Bert Cooper in the series of Mad Men. And then for you musical theater nerds out there, the great moment, spoiler alert on an old TV series, but when Bert Cooper's character dies, the final episode that his character appears on in the show, he appears as a ghost to Don Draper with five dancing girls, and Robert Morse's character sings "The Best Things in Life Are Free."
I remember that.
And that acknowledged his musical, because they never acknowledged Robert Morse's musical theater history until that final episode.
Was that the acid trip episode?
What?
That was like an acid trip episode, right?
No, it was the Don was sad that Bert died and he was seeing him for the last time episode. But
okay.
But anyway, that's at Footlight Musicals. That's running one final weekend there. And then just hanging out with the missus and doing the public radio nonsense. You know, business as usual.
Well, I hope to see you on stage. I'm in Indiana. I don't know for how long, but you never know. I would love to see you on stage.
Indie Bar Fest is coming up in the fall, so we'll see. It's tough being a free agent.
It is, but it's fun. We wouldn't have it any other way. What are you drinking, Matthew? Ah, nice. Jameson.
Yeah.
And that's nice. The fancy one. That's the fancy one. Tommy, I'm going to go right to you because a lot of times you're drinking that as well. What do you got, sir?
My Irish coffee today.
Okay, cool. We're still on the Irish theme.
Yeah.
Michael?
That's a neat transition because got my faithful Woodford Reserve is all. Yeah.
Well, that's more on the Scott-Irish side, Kentuckian.
Brown liquid. Team brown liquid.
Brown liquor gets you there quicker. And Stephanie, what are you having, my dear?
Well, because I missed Mass at 6:30 a.m., it's a holy day of obligation. I can't drink. I have to drink.
Oh, I thought you were having wine. Well, why can't you have wine if you miss Mass? Because do you drink wine there, like the communion wine?
No.
What's wrong with having it at another time? I mean, seriously.
What
rule book is that?
That's transubstantiation, I think.
No, it's the fact that I don't want to get arrested for drunk driving or even being buzzed.
And Dee Dee, okay. You get one sip with the host. You don't get to chug the chalice.
No, and they don't.
That's what I'm saying. This is an opportunity to
at our church, they don't do both. It's just the bread.
They don't
it's
do
the whiteheads.
I don't. Churches are so confusing to me because some do Kool-Aid or grape juice or wine, and then you just
that
do
was
the bread.
Jim Jones, Dee Dee. Stop
yeah,
that.
That was Waco. That was Waco, Texas. That was a different
thing. Another Hoosier, by the way, Jim Jones.
We can't.
You guys don't have to clean that.
Do not go there with me because my dad would say, he turned water into wine. I think I can have a beer if I want.
No, yeah. Hey.
I agree.
So.
And that goes with the theme of this show. And I'll tell you what I'm having, this beautiful blue drink, which I just love this color. It's so
is
cool.
Is that what they had in The Mandalorian?
Did you remove the combs from the barbershop out of it?
Hpnotiq. I can't say anything with an accent. Hpnotiq, but in a French way, because it's a French liqueur, which goes with our theme today.
Hpnotiq.
It's good. It is actually good. Yeah. It's like a melon, kind of. But it's because we're talking about... Okay, I'm not even going to say it yet, because I'm going to mess it up, Matthew. How do you say the C-A-N-N-E-S?
Film the Cannes Film Festival.
Cannes. Okay.
Cannes.
Gone, like in Star Trek.
No, but you can say it that. Look, it's like the old Buddy Hackett joke. If you drive a Ford, it's Yom Kippur. If you drive an Oldsmobile, it's Yom Kippur. If you drive a Rolls Royce, it's Christmas. It's Cannes. It's Cannes. It's that film festival in France.
Because I always thought it was Cannes, and they're like, "Oh no, it's Cannes." I said, "I've never heard it like that before, I don't know."
Yeah, it's like, hey, I gotta hit the can before we start.
I know, con sounds more like elegant.
So, Dee Dee, just tell them to remove the stick from their ass. Do that.
Okay. Yeah, boy, we've missed you. I'm so glad you're back, Matthew.
What if somebody
not the
did
same
that?
Without you.
What if you said that to somebody and they go, huh, I never thought that.
Like the dog?
Yeah. So, folks, you know, I was just reading about the... Con Festival. And of course, the big buzz is Johnny Depp.
Who?
And the Johnny Depp and the Jean Dubarry, the Madame Dubarry story.
Jean Dubarry.
Jean Dubarry. It's not Jean.
Well, it's Jean and it's Jean in English, but the French would pronounce it Jean Dubarry.
It's Jean Claude Van Damme.
Well, that's Brussels, Michael. It's
Jean Dubarry. You know, all right, dog.
All right, just a minute. I didn't think you guys could hear that. I'll be right back.
Oh, yeah, we can hear it. So anyway, you know, at the film festival, the first...
Okay, house.
No, it never fails. There's always something. Never a dull moment here at Drinks with Dee Dee. Go to the dogs.
Dog's like, I want to be on the show, man. I want to be on the show. I have things to say.
Zoom.
And then he'll, like, lick himself for 20 minutes.
Yeah, that's the...
Then Zoom is like, let's always cut to the microphone where the person's putting the dog away.
Do it.
So do you even like Johnny Depp? I mean, on this show, we talked about if he would win the case. And,
I thought this was a pro-Johnny show.
It is.
Yeah.
It is. So, I mean, but we, you know, we tend to be right on the show. We've got smart cookies here, and we tend to be very... we just tend to be right, and we all thought Johnny Depp was going to win, and he did. But do you all like him? I like him. I think he's an interesting character, and I'm glad that he's doing well.
Do I need to timeshare a condo with him?
No. Oh, no. Okay, no way, Jose. That is not happening.
So what we're doing is we're separating the
artist
from the art.
Yes. What is with the dog?
The last piece of info I saw about Depp is from... Take it from what it's worth. It's called The Onion, my favorite satirical newspaper. And I remember they did a thing. Johnny Depp, now just a series of hats and scarves.
Well, that's me.
No, you're, I mean, we can see you. You know, there are times he looks like he's auditioning for the Claude Rains role in The Invisible Man. So, yeah, make your movies. I don't need to see you. I don't need to do things on your bed or have things done upon your bed. Yeah, so
well, that's a different movie for sure. And you know,
movie.
They may be out there. My guess is they probably are. I'm not really interested in that movie.
I'm gonna go with you might introduce him to us one day, so I'm gonna say yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, I do have people I know very well that know him very well. You never know. And yeah, Johnny Depp is kind of out there, so he may go, yeah, I'll do it. I mean, you never know.
And our Kentucky show, Dee Dee. So in Kentucky, in my hometown, we have a castle. Interesting.
and even more interesting if you're driving
down the road and you make a left 2 minutes, that's where his mom's.
Oh, house. And by the way, a castle close to Versailles, of course, in France, yeah. It's Versailles, but that's a little tie-in as well.
Yep.
No castle buying. Nick Cage will tell you, no castle buying.
Oh, yeah, that didn't work out well for him. Castles. He bought all kinds of crazy stuff.
Brad Pitt may buy it.
No castles, no islands. It's
not going to work well. And try Kim Basinger whenever she tried to buy a town.
Well, that was.
How do you even do that? I don't even know how you even do it.
It's Georgia for one thing. So it's
Georgia.
It was quite a bit, but yeah, no towns, no islands, no castles. You don't. That's not how the real estate game works.
Yeah, you're so right. They all go bankrupt, don't they?
That's a lot of repair and upkeep.
I could say that for myself, when I buy a town, my ego might kind of get out of check a little bit. That's just for me. I don't know about anybody else.
Yeah, so, well, she never recovered. Yeah, never here's recovered.
Here's some Johnny Depp news. Apparently, Amber Heard is living in Spain under an assumed name now.
The rain in Spain falls mainly on the plane. Nobody cares what she's doing, though. That's the funny part. And even her friends were bashing Johnny Depp like he looks bad, which he does look a little weird.
Yeah.
Is she on Tinder yet?
What?
On Tinder yet?
On Tinder.
Oh, God. Probably. Look under.
Oh, I thought that was fans only. I thought that was the naked side.
Yeah, fans only.
Isn't that what you meant, Tommy? I know you're going to look for it. Shame on you. No. That's bad. I'm telling Lydia. Although she'll laugh. Lydia will just laugh.
Artistically, I look.
No, if she was on Tinder, every guy would go, no, thank you.
She's a beautiful woman. She is. She's an Aquaman, gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous. She just is. But after that, nobody likes her. Not because they don't think she's pretty on the inside, so people don't look at her the same way. Except for Tommy's favorite side, fans only.
Fans only. Oh, by the way, check out my fans only page.
Oh, God.
Do you all know anybody?
It's called Tommy Thunder Down Under.
Oh, God. Dee Dee, do you have a pin? I want to poke my mind's eye out now.
Yeah, I do, but I'm not giving it to you because we don't want that here. But do any of you know a fans only person? I don't know anybody who does it. Or I don't know. I know someone does that. Is it that commonplace?
I know an actress. She lives in San Diego, and she put on something on Instagram. Said, "I'm setting up my fans only account." And I sent her a message and said, "You're kidding me, right?"
Isn't that what she was calling funny, but
I think a lot of people took it seriously. But no, I don't know anybody.
Anyway, moving on from that. But back to the Cannes Film Festival and Johnny Depp. And you know, Matthew, I love the movie Marie Antoinette with what's her face?
Oh, Kirsten Dunst, directed by Sofia Coppola.
No, the old one. Yeah. The old one.
That was a
what the hell is her name? She was a big time movie star.
Norma Scherer.
Yes. Thank you so much. I thought she was excellent. You know, and then the guy. You know, I am terrible with names today, but just a great movie. But the Jean Dubarry or Madame Dubarry or whatever was like a pivotal character in the movie. It was like a 3-hour movie or something, and I loved it. In black and white, loved it.
Yeah.
But she was a major character. So I want to see this movie. I think it'd be interesting because, you know, because typical French way, hey, it's the sex workers' world and let's applaud it. It's fine. It's good. I mean, that's what they're saying, you know, this is great because it applauds sex workers. Like, it's okay. And look, I don't care if you want to do that. No, whatever. I don't even care. And Stephanie, I know because you go to church and you're religious, but you miss this morning, so don't be too judgmental about me saying I don't care if they do that.
I don't. I look. I do not do that at all because
I wasn't saying we're doing it. Now you sound guilty, you do that or you did that. Did you do
no,
that?
No, I mean,
I feel like
no,
maybe
I don't.
You did because now you're acting guilty. I'm just saying you sound pretty damn guilty. Kind of. I mean, you're hot. I mean, you could be a sex worker. No judgment here. I told you that.
Is that your sideline?
Mom, stop! No. You're embarrassing me.
I saw you in Craigslist in Pennsylvania.
Oh dear God!
Oh, no. Backhanded compliment of the year, right there.
Yes, yes. I that would no, dear God, no, no.
You're butterfingers, you honey. You're a high class.
All right, moving on from that. Well, it's okay. It's all right. But you skipped church. It's your fault. I mean, not ours.
I'm going to church after this, so.
Well,
I'm not
so you say?
Yeah, you better.
You better.
If I open up the bottle of Chardonnay that I have and start drinking, then you know I wouldn't. But I am because.
Okay.
My husband will get mad at me if I don't, and I.
Because you have to drive to church. What you can't Uber. Yeah.
Jesus turned water into wine and hung out with prostitutes, so it's all good.
I want to say this. It would be nice to go kind of buzz just because there's something going on there. I will tell Dee Dee later.
Tell me now.
Oh, there's this.
Tell me now. You know, have to say it.
Church
just
drama.
Say it.
We got some church drama. Imagine.
Yeah, we do. We do.
There's our God is an awesome God.
We don't say that. If we did, I would leave. I would leave if they did that.
That's a Six Flags Over Jesus churches.
She's got some issues, and she's 25 years old.
No shame. What are you talking about?
This girl. Now listen.
I don't care about this girl. Now what about Johnny Depp?
No, 25-year-old.
All right.
Wait, it's gonna come back to him. It's gonna come back to him. Yeah. Just
okay,
wait.
Let's go back. Let's go back to the film festival because this is complicated.
No, go ahead. Well, if it's a really good story, which I don't believe it is. I think you know. Until
like
you start drinking, I'm
story.
Not interested.
No, it's one where I often think I need a judge's restraining order.
No, okay. And that's not the story we want to tell. Okay, let's go back to the French Film Festival. So I think it's cool that they're doing this because this is about French history. So I have a history degree. I love it. I love the geeky stuff. Matthew, I don't know about you. I don't know about the rest of you, but I love whenever, even if it's loosely based, I think it's just great. Like, so I'm going to watch it. I'm going to, me too. I'm going to go see it. Think it'll be good. And Johnny Depp is doing great as well because he got like a gazillion dollar perfume contract or cologne, I guess, for guys. Isn't that crazy? Like the highest paid ever.
Well, yeah.
The highest paid ever.
A lot of actors, a lot of American actors and actresses will get, obviously go to Europe, they'll go to Asia, and they'll get more money for doing an ad than they will a film. One of my favorites is that Sir Ian McKellen got paid more money to do the voice for the Lord of the Rings video game than he actually did for making Lord of the Rings.
Oh my God.
You can do a search of American actors in foreign ads and you will get a scroll list of people who have done it. You know, if they ask you, go for it. I mean, that's the whole basis.
Yeah, why not?
That's the whole basis of the plot of Lost in Translation. Bill Murray plays an American actor who goes to Japan for a Suntory ad. And, you know, Suntory is going to pay more than some films these days.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? My favorite, Matthew and you guys, my favorite of that is David Hasselhoff. I mean, come on. So he did Baywatch. But in Germany, he's a god.
He's a god in Germany.
He
you go to where the work is. There's a fine documentary filmmaker named Mike Malloy, who I've had on my show a few times. But he did a great documentary called Eurocrime, which was about the cop and mob films in Italy in the 1970s. And there were a number of American actors, you know, just like in the spaghetti westerns in the 60s and the cop films in the 70s. where you could go back and forth. You could make major films and maybe have smaller major films in the States and then be a huge star in Italy.
That's upon a time in Hollywood.
Exactly. Oh my God, you beat me to it, Michael. Yep. That's what I was going to say. And remember Leonardo DiCaprio, which I think he's great in a movie, by the way. He was bitching about it like crazy. Yeah. Fuck. Because Al Pacino's like, oh, you can do the Italian movies.
And yeah,
I read a good article about that where where Michael J. Fox said the one scene where he's getting mad about memorizing the lines made him like decide to retire from acting because it was
Michael
so
J. Active. Fox.
Yeah, he was like, "That's too."
Well,
real.
He's probably struggling already, right?
And there's a documentary about Fox right now. But one of my favorite actual real life con stories is another guy I've interviewed and hung out with a little bit. Let me pick up the name I dropped. Of Fred Williamson. Fred Williamson was a blaxploitation star in the early 70s.
I remember him.
He formed his own production company where he would produce and direct his own films.
Porn?
And, no, you wish.
We're talking about Dolomite.
No, that's Rudy Ray Moore.
but no, similar. Yeah, but.
No.
Sorry.
Fred's a slightly better karate.
You thought you were wanting to compliment Michael, and now, see.
No, I know. He's 2 for 3 now. He would bring his canisters under his arm, go to Cannes, make deals with Italy, make deals with distributors in France and Italy and Germany, and he'd make more money distributing in Europe than he would be in being in Black Caesar 5 here in the U.S.
Yeah. And he's Black been doing Caesar 5. Is there a Black Caesar 5?
No, he did Black Caesar, then Hell Up in Harlem, and that's it.
Okay.
Yeah, I think I've seen Black Caesar, but I know
it's
who you're
really
talking
good.
About.
I'm a huge blaxploitation fan, as is Michael. They're well told stories. It's just you got a cheaper budget, and Fred Williamson was able to have way more charisma than the average retired football player turned actor.
Yeah,
and they're fun to watch.
Can you believe O.J. Simpson was in movies? Isn't it? Sure.
Yeah.
I mean, not big movies, but he was like a big cameo. Big cameo. You're right. They were big movies.
Naked Gun.
He was in the Towering Inferno.
Yeah,
Cassandra Cross.
Naked Gun was.
He was in the Nicole, I'm going to beat the shit out of you film. He was in the White Bronco Story. So, no.
Well, that for sure. And you know, go ahead, Matthew, but after that, you know where I'm going to go, Michael.
Yes, I do, too.
Yeah.
No, so, but anyway, for a lot of athletes or, a lot of former pro or college athletes, don't forget Burt Reynolds was going to be a football player before he tore up his knee in college and went into acting. Fred Williamson looked at Jim Brown and went, I could do that. And, so long as you've got a little charisma about you a great example, Dwayne Johnson. He doesn't have to be.
Oh my gosh. He's so rich.
Rich. Yeah. So. He doesn't have to bang his limbs and have, his joints turn to putty by the time he's 50. He's set.
Yeah.
For sure. Yeah. I don't think Black Adam did well, though. I didn't even understand what Black Adam was.
One drop in his well.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. He got paid for it. He got paid well for it. Yeah. Didn't have to get, maybe not back from the movie, but, they get, he's making money up front for sure. And he does have a lot of charisma. I mean, but my gosh, he's so rich. So rich.
Yep.
Just saying, he's so rich, he's not that damn good of an actor. I like him, but he's not really a great actor, but you don't have to.
He's getting better.
Well, as you mentioned, Matthew, the White Bronco, there's a connect. And, I would love it if we all made movies and then did what Matthew said, to go to Cannes and sell them. Yeah. We all make a gazillion dollars. And then we invite each other in all of our movies. Wouldn't it be great? So that's always my dream, that all of the Drinks with Dee Dee people, we all make movies. We're all in each other's movies. We help each other out and just have a fun party with it. So leading to that, Michael actually, as we said before, has a whole movie. But he also has a whole trailer, and it mentions the Bronco. So I'm wondering, Tony, the boss, if we can play and set it up, Michael, to play the trailer to your movie. Yay!
Hey, so Tony, I put it in the chat there, the link. But this is a fun film that I made about a guy who's a slacker and he gets his act together driving monster trucks. So
that'd be big in Indiana, I'm telling you.
Enjoy.
Edit.
Anyway.
Hit it, Tony!
That was a cut. So probably this won't.
And what's it called? What's it called, Michael?
The finish line. Check it out. Okay. Here it is.
Billy Baker is a slacker.
So there's a lot down the street. We actually don't have anything like that. But
is it bad?
Does a peacock show his feathers? Does a black woman here, you know, get shrivelly in the heat?
I really don't know that.
Dude, Trip Trippy wants to see it.
You're selling fuel economy cars here at Trip Trippies. I don't sell trucks. It would be nice if you just fired yourself and let yourself go and know that I do like you, Billy.
Can I at least have a candy bar?
Stacy, get Billy Baker some Snickers, would you?
And his life is flipped upside down.
Sharky! Knew I had that pool rodeo coming up next month.
Your big sister's got an idea that I think will work. No fun, but boots.
You can't finish. Get in there.
Until Billy gets back to basics.
It's a hard one. It's a hard one to get into.
And do whatever it takes to get his family back.
Hope you're running Ohio, Louisiana's I will. And if it is,
I haven't seen driving like that since June 1994, Southern California. You ever driven a white Bronco?
I would love to have you as part of my tour.
Really?
Yes.
It's your everyday knuckle-clutching, gear-jamming, super trucking, loose nut behind.
I just hope you consider there's been so much more good than bad so far.
It's a tale of racing.
What happened, dude?
Lost my job.
Jesse!
Yeah?
Hey, how would you like to be my pit crew chief leader?
Seriously?
Mm-hmm.
Hey, kid, get over here. Hustle. Let's go. Come on. How would you like to be part of my pit crew?
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Hey, I quit my job!
Wow, it's probably the nicest thing you've done in the last, maybe even ever. See you on the track, Powers.
That was an empty offer, kid. You were never gonna work for me.
Family. Ah. And doing whatever it takes.
If you finish this championship and you win, then you can move back in.
To finish the race.
Wait, really?
Yeah.
Michael Gilkison is Billy Baker in the finish line.
Super drunk and loose nut behind.
What can I do, man?
Just hang tough, put your foot to the floor, and go like crazy.
How did you get Christian Bale's Batman to do the voiceover?
How'd you get into Con?
It's all who you know. It's all
He's racing over on his jet to Con right now, and he's going to have that under his arm, like Matthew like said, and, you know, it, like man. Fred. Just
that's
go for it.
Yeah, that's pretty much what I'm doing now. Seriously.
Congratulations, Michael. I mean, seriously, to put a movie together, I mean, who does it? I mean, that is hard. I mean, wonderful chair. And actually, hey, Tommy, let's go ahead and just do the pictures as we're cheering to Michael. Okay. Well, let's just get that done. So we remember.
Thank you, guys. I'm a different person having gone through it.
I bet. But wait a minute. I got the cup in there. Okay, got it.
Thank you.
Yay. So, Michael, but you had a damn Buckeye kind of bucket it up, right? Your movie, the editor. Did he ever get it together or no? Or are you just trying to be nice here? Because I know you hate his God. So, you mean, did he ever get it right?
I had to put him on probation, but he did a good job filming, but we just kind of had creative differences, and I heard that happens in every production.
Yeah.
But, I mean, really, it's just like, you gotta just take it. It's like rugby, you know? You gotta throw the ball back and keep running. You gotta make sure somebody's always running with it, and that's kind of what this has been.
Well, congratulations. It is great.
You, yeah.
For a while, you never know where it will go. You never know where it will go. I think it'll be successful. It looks cute to me. It's like a feel good and funny, but not raunchy, which is hard to do.
It's a nice little, you know, summer action comedy family flick. It's low budget. It's good and funny. So, I mean,
so Matthew, don't you think that it's creative and it was, I think, really clever to use monster trucks as a topic?
Look, there was actually a big budgeted film that nobody saw called Monster Trucks, and you might be able to get a bigger audience than that film. My question is, who's the babe with the hat?
Yeah, who's the babe with the
hat?
Well,
I can introduce you to her.
That's Chrissy Baker.
You know those Hoosier women, although I was born in Kentucky, so I'm calling myself a Kentuckiana woman. But, you know, look, Matthew, Tommy, Stephanie, of course, you were, you have included me, and we've done like a little bit before with Flip Mode, but Matthew is perfect for something in a movie, right? He's got like that perfect look.
I'm glad
you got to cast him next time.
No, I'm glad you got the other guy to do the wedgie scene. I hope that was one take.
I don't even understand. I was like, I keep meaning to ask you, what does it do with the wedgie? I mean, is that your kid or is it a man or who's what?
That's I'm a afraid guy thing.
That's my cousin. Yeah. So I have cousins and nephews in this film. And, you know, I really get it now because before people were like, oh, Hollywood's all nepotism. Well, sometimes you need some people to be
why
in
not?
Your film. You
they,
know?
Why not? Yeah.
They can be the best family reunions as a project.
Yeah.
I mean,
they're great for background.
Yeah.
When it comes down to it and you're like, hey, I got to shoot this scene next Saturday. Can you be, you can't be there. I need somebody in it. It's like, you need somebody. Yes.
So. Yeah. But with family, you can get grandma on a call and say, look, you're going to Michael's movie, mister. I mean, and they're going to have to go.
I really, when I gave him the wedgie, it broke the button on his pants. And of course,
that wasn't a button. No, I've been directed by my kid, my wife, both my in-laws.
Yeah.
I've directed my kid. My kid's directed me. So yeah, we're you know what I think you when people think of nepotism in show business, they think spelling, but others it's like, well, you just got to finish a project. So
I think Kasdan, but Larry Kasdan, Jonathan Kasdan. Mm-hmm. That's what I think.
So yeah, Tommy, like you're a filmmaker as well. You know, I mean, I know you'll be nice, but you know, what are your thoughts on Michael's project?
I think it's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
I love
it's
it.
Cute, isn't it?
It is.
And Matthew, you are a critic. What do you think about the trailer, at least?
Well, first off, I don't review trailers because they're trailers.
I know you
the
don't.
The job is to make the film look good.
Right. So, I know, but...
No, Michael, send me a link and I would love to... I love to, when it's available, I'd love to check it out.
It's available.
Well, where is it available, Michael?
Well, it
from
is...
From Michael, the link.
It's under my arm right now.
Yeah.
I'm metaphorically going to cans with this thing.
Always be hustling. Always
Matthew,
hustling.
You know what? Here's a thought. What do you think? Don't you think it would be a good entry for Heartland Film Festival?
Look, there. You throw a
I
rock.
I think it fits. Think about it.
If you throw a rock, you can get a film festival nowadays. So
I know, but I think Heartland's good because it's Indiana. So, you know, and Matthew's a god there. And also, it's Monster Truck and it's family. I just think it
there's,
fits.
There are at least three film festivals in Indiana that I know of. Hoosier, there's Indiana, there's Heartland, there's Indie Film Fest, there's an organization in Bloomington. Like I said, you just, you type in a state and you go to Google, type in a state and film festivals, you're set. Just you send it out as much as you can, hopefully and even better or even worse, maybe depending on how much of a fee they want. It's almost like getting admitted into college, but you know how much you're willing to give up to try to get your product out there, especially on the festival circuit.
And you can win somewhere, Michael.
And man, there is something about even if you see the you know, the drinks with Dee Dee festival, you know, jury festival. But the fact that you...
Oh, yeah, for sure. Matthew Socey gives the finish line 5 stars.
That's what I mean.
You just keep the affiliation in the smallest type whenever possible. But if it's a major publication and a major festival, you blow that up.
That's great advice. Yeah. Well, I don't know if you'll make the Cannes Film Festival. I think if you went over there, you would get attention. Go ahead, Michael.
My short film Flip Mode got an honorable mention at the French Riviera Film Festival.
Oh, cool!
Well, a separate section for if you have shorts and if you have some different things, you could get it into one of those.
Go hang out with Lloyd Kaufman from Trauma. See, that's it. I mean, that's the thing where, I'm sorry, where when people think of con, they think of like the high prestige stuff, and that's out there. But the fact that folks like Fred Williamson, like Trauma films with Lloyd Kaufman, Cannon films back in the 80s, the Golden Globus guys, man, they would give you a poster with either Charles Bronson or Chuck Norris, and, you know, 10 countries would pick up, give them money for distribution. And the film hadn't been made yet.
Oh,
you got to finish products. Yes. So.
And I love films like that, too. You know, my favorite Chuck Norris film is Firewalker. And, of course, Dolomite. That movie inspired me a bunch.
Because
it's like, hey, just make it. Just do it. And then they tried to shut him out. And he's like, well, I'm just going to four-wall it. I'm going to play it in a theater. And then the distribution company gave him another chance. They said, whoa, hey, we were wrong. Because a lot of people want to see this. Mm-hmm. So...
Well- Yeah, I mean, I'm amazed with any filmmaker. I just was like, how do you just, for one, you have to make it, which is difficult, and then you get it out there. And, you know, Matthew, what you're talking about, and Tommy and Michael, I mean, you know the world, and it is just a challenge. So you just get out there and do it, and it seems like it's so much different than it used to be. But in a way, for people like Michael, I'm thinking that's a good thing.
Yeah,
it's a real good.
Wild, wild west. Why not?
Make it work. Did Paul ever go?
He did. You know? He was a judge once.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
He was a judge at the Cannes Film Festival, and he loved it. And one of the wishes he wanted for us, so thank you for asking, Matthew, it was I just want to hang on a yacht south of France with you, Dee Dee. I think that would be so much fun. I said, okay, I'm in. Why not? We never made it, unfortunately. But
yes, but if you did, what wine would you have?
Sorvino Vino! Woo! Thank you for mentioning that, too. That is awesome.
That is the wine that I want to serve at the premiere of this film.
Yes!
See, deals. These are how deals are made.
All going. You know, I always went the crew with us. You know, I always think that's a good thing. I think that brings good vibes.
I tried to go down and get a bottle of it last Sunday, and I couldn't.
Go to Temecula?
Yeah, they were restricting. You had to have a reservation to go into the vin.
Oh,
no!
Because
of Mother's Day. And I'm sitting there, all I want to do is buy this one bottle.
Did you drop Paul Sorvino's name? Did you drop up? Believe me, you should have called me. You would have gotten that bottle. Don't worry. Next time, if you do it again, I'll make a call and you're all set.
I'll make a trip down.
Speaking of like mafia calls, at the Cannes Film Festival, Martin Scorsese has a movie.
He does.
The festival. Matthew, what do you know about that movie?
Not a lot. They just dropped the trailer today. And
did you see it?
I saw the trailer. It's a trailer. Also, the trailer doesn't tell you.
We know you don't review trailers. We're just asking your opinion. It's a friend.
The trailer doesn't tell you. It's over 3.5 hours.
Oh, God.
So this is Irish length.
The trailer?
No, the film.
Look, I'm not going to criticize Martin Scorsese. No. You know, Paul loved him, called him Marty. But why are his movies so long?
No. Hold on. There are 3.5 hour movies that are riveting and move along, and there are 80-minute films that feel like the Bataan Death March.
That's true.
Yeah. So, and I was fortunate enough, I saw The Irishman in a theater, and I was enthralled by it. So, all I know about this one is it's a period piece. DiCaprio is in a small American town with a Native American woman. That's to quote my kid watching first Hamlet for the first time. This isn't going to end good.
No.
But you got Jesse Plemons and Brendan Fraser and Robert De Niro. Scorsese is my favorite filmmaker.
Of course.
So I'm down for it.
Me too. I'm with you. I just wondered because I wasn't even sure what it was about. So thank you for shedding light on that.
That's just a general. I haven't looked deep into the whole plot of it, but that from the trailer, that's what you get out of it. So, but strap it down, folks. You're in for a ride.
It's a Western, right? That's what it looks like to me.
Yes and no. I mean, it's set. That's like saying the Johnny Depp film, Old Man, or was it Big Man, is a Western. It's not all Western, not all films set in the Old West are Westerns.
Yeah.
So I would say, it's like Power of the Dog, not really a Western, but, it's an expensive period piece because, was it Netflix or Paramount or both?
I think it was Netflix.
They're letting him. I think. So because... Yeah. Irishman did actually better than a lot of folks expected, so go for it.
Yeah,
and De Niro, I mean, you know, he's an interesting character these days. What, he's got 7 kids instead of 6. Wasn't kind of the last
still
story
got
about
pencil.
Bobby? Look, those guys can do no wrong for me. They all showed up and contributed to Paul's celebration of life. Good guys. And I agree with you, Matthew, that Martin Scorsese, the genius that he is, anything, he does no wrong with me. I love the man. So, you know, I totally want to go to that. Sounds, but I didn't know what it was. I mean, and people just keep talking about that it's so long. Well, okay, you made a great point. So what?
Yeah, I directed a 3-hour and 45-minute play. I'm going to see, next month, I'm going to see both parts of Angels in America. That's 7 hours. So,
wow.
But then again, how many shows have we streamed? How many shows have we binged watch? How many,
yeah,
you
exactly,
know,
exactly, right?
A season,
you know, that's
whatever.
A good point. When you binge watch, it's a whole weekend. I mean,
yeah.
You just don't stop.
The difference is you have to actually pay for concessions. And you can't stop the film. You have to time when you go pee and get popcorn in the theater. I think a lot of us have forgotten that.
Because and they tend to arrest you sitting there nude with your wife.
Tommy, I want to go
with
you, cowboy. What
oh
movie theaters
God.
Are you going to? And can we
Pee-wee Herman, hello? You and Pee-wee Herman going to the same theater.
Diddy read my mind. I was going to bring up Pee-wee.
Tommy, are you opening a chain of nudist cinemas? Is that what
the... It's not a bad idea.
They tried it with the laundromat cinemas. Why not? Huh?
Good Lord.
Well, Tommy, I mean, you're a filmmaker as well. Are you going to get into nude filmmaking or you know, like porno? Well, I feel like you're thinking.
No, I don't find it appealing.
The cast is clothed. The crew is naked.
Oh, God.
Yeah, there you go.
That's funny. Yeah, how about the crew? And they get to work on these shows with these movie stars and they're naked. And, you know, they're loving it, I'm sure. But
watch out that clapperboard.
I mean, it's creepy. Very creepy.
Yeah,
to be,
it is.
Like,
turned into a bris.
So if you all got paid enough money, would you do a nude scene in a movie?
No.
I charge by the pound.
The thing is they've gone to this sensationalism of seeing a star or somebody naked and gotten away from what it takes to be an actor and how they create the character in that. That's why I don't like it. I could care less about if there's nudity in a film.
Naked, I don't believe naked. You, Tommy.
Huh?
I don't believe you. I don't believe any of you men.
Be very sexy.
I think you are all. I don't believe any of you. I think that if there's nudity and it's a beautiful woman and well-known, you're looking.
The use of body doubles have gotten better as far as filmmaking and timing. And the other part is with your hypothetical question. Yeah, who's my co-star? And, you know, because to be fair, there's also Ewan McGregor and Harvey Keitel. Y'all can look it up. I'm not helping you.
I know what you're talking about.
I don't help.
Thank you, Steph. You have so give Father one of my best. So.
I will. No,
Stephanie. What is it?
Harvey Keitel on the piano.
And Bad Lieutenant.
I don't want to see him naked. I've met him in real life. I don't want to see him naked. But McGregor.
Well,
yep.
You and McGregor. I can't remember the
pillow
movie,
book.
Was it? Oh yes.
He's Star Wars guy, right? Am I wrong? Am I?
Yes.
Do I have
he
the right guy?
Way before
plays,
Star Wars.
Yeah, this
DiCaprio
was like way
even,
before.
DiCaprio even did one.
See, I would watch. Look, I'm just going to be honest. I'm for that. I'm good with that. I'm watching.
I've got one you guys probably don't realize.
What?
Frantic. Harrison Ford.
Oh, yes.
Just for a second.
You love
just for
him.
A second.
Directed
you
by
see his wiener? No, you don't see Han Solo's wiener.
Stephanie has.
Woo! I want to see that, too.
Stephanie would like to thank the pause button.
Yes. No. When I first saw that movie, my sister took me to it because it was rated R. And she's like,
because
here's the deal.
Han Solo's wiener?
It's back in the 80s, there was some stuff in that movie that was a little bit. And it was directed by Roman Polanski.
Yep.
And we're watching that scene.
Say no more.
Flying out of that door, and I'm going, and Joan's like, I don't know where to look.
Because I'm looking right.
It was right split there. Second, but it was enough to make us both go.
To do the rewind?
Yeah. But no, we were at the movie.
See, that's the thing. Think about before. I'm sorry if I may. Before home video, because nobody thought we were going to have movies at home. I mean, nobody thought we would, because nobody would thought we were going to watch stuff on TV because it would be in the movie. At one point, it would be in the movies and it would disappear.
So it'll just be a flash.
Right.
Yeah.
So to speak.
Yeah.
So then, then the pause button. How many films have we rented, Michael? I know you and I have done this. There's one scene in Fast Times at Ridgemont High that if you rent it, it has been warped because it has been rewound and watched so
Phoebe
much.
Phoebe Cates. Yep. No, she's a gorgeous woman. I mean, look, I'm not into women.
But Stephanie,
but gorgeous woman.
We have all done the pause button of tink there.
I think I did that. Right, I rented it out. Rented it out in college.
I knew it would come along.
We got
drunk
with my friends and watched it. We did that. And then we giggled. Yeah. And then, you know, it was funny. And we were drunk off our asses, so there you go.
I'm in.
But, yeah, it was, that was my very first movie where I actually saw someone that I really admire.
Naked.
Naked. And I was like.
Wiener.
And my sister was like, I don't know whether to cut.
I know, but I like it when the guys show the wieners because they never do. It's always the women.
Yes, because guys are terrible and run Hollywood.
Interesting to me, the woman. I mean, look, I can admire them, like BB Kate's a gorgeous woman, but I want to see, you know, the men, and that's rare. It's usually men you don't see.
Yep.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
I know you all want that, but still, I think
just watch Judd Apatow films.
No.
Ew. Why do I think that's wrong?
Because they're all 20 minutes too long. But then
and then the wrong. The wrong guy is naked usually too, and it's like
the what guy?
The wrong guy.
Oh, wrong guy. You know what?
Wait a minute.
No
are you
joke.
Referring to that? Not all. If you go to a nudist colony, they all don't look like that.
My sister took my.
You never. I've never been to one, but that's where you don't want to go because it's always the people you don't want to see naked.
Exactly. Exactly.
And they're all there.
And it's, yeah.
No. Well, Tommy, clearly you know. I can tell you know from experience. Even though you're like, Oh, no, I don't like nudity in films. Liar, liar, liar. You know you're a liar. Hey, I'm in mourning and I admit it. If it's a hot guy, I'm telling you, back in the day, Christopher Reeve was naked. I'm going to that movie like 82 times. I was a beautiful man.
Stephanie, I hate to bring this up, but I just listened to another podcast, which I won't mention on this podcast, but they talked.
Why not? We don't care.
All right, fine. You must remember this. They were doing
a kiss is just a kiss.
And they talked about presumed innocent, or as I like to refer to it as Harrison Ford's hernia checkup.
Yeah. I liked that movie, but the end, I'm like.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that was a hot sex scene. That's what you're talking about, right?
Yeah, I'm like, can she still go to jail for this? What in the?
No, that makes it worse.
I mean, he is screwed. He is screwed.
Literally and figuratively.
Like, and he did it to himself.
Yep.
And it's like,
you know, and then you have like the bunny that gets cooked on the stove. I mean, you know, sex really makes people crazy.
That was hair-raising.
That was also a pot boiler, Tommy.
Yeah, that was.
Never fails where this show goes. I mean, we're talking about Con, and it's all about nudity and sex and movies, and why not?
Hey, Glenn Close and Michael Duck.
But she was so unattractive. There's no fucking way that he is going to be attracted to her.
The problem with Fatal Attraction is, and then of course that's the whole suspension of disbelief and the storyline. But you know, if you those of us who remember, and I do, the first shot of Ann Archer in that film, I'm like, if you're cheating on her, you're an idiot.
But let's go. Okay,
isn't that the case?
To that point, look about. Hugh Grant and Elizabeth Hurley. What the fuck?
We know what Liz won't do. Now we all know what Liz won't do. So. Yeah.
What is, I mean.
But still, my gosh, you're going to go there? Holy moly.
I wasn't there. I didn't drive.
No, I think nudity or sex or whatever in movies can be quite interesting. I mean, I'm for it.
If it's done right. And, you know, the thing about Frantic is that it was there and done. And you guys asked
Stephanie, I think you would cheat. You would cheat with Han Solo. You would, even though you're a church girl, you mention him in every podcast. You would cheat with Han Solo against Rudy. I know you would.
No, I wouldn't.
Tell.
I wouldn't.
Honey, you
I
have the peanuts on your Facebook page almost as much as Eric's support.
Every day, no, you're talking about Han Solo.
If you're acting, you're not really yourself. You're making yourself into somebody else. You got to look at it that way.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's true. But no,
it's condom. It's not cheating. It's there's no skin to skin contact.
Oh God, stop it!
Tommy. Yeah, you know what? You're not saying much this podcast, but when you say something, you're saying
she's
it.
She's not gonna ask Harrison Ford to run away.
Like you're
her,
not. If you're
no,
if Han Solo wears a condom, according to Tommy, you're not cheating.
That's right. You ask him to build a cabin.
Look, here's the deal. The reason why I do that is because I look at actors today.
You love him. Just you want him.
Let me finish. I do that because actors today are not movie stars, and he is.
I agree.
And I feel like we don't have that connection to what makes movies so special. And so many people on the side that I'm a libertarian now, I'm not a conservative anymore because I am so sick of them at times.
Matthew agrees.
They stick their noses up every time they hear the word movie, Hollywood, actor, filmmaker. And I know so many people in the business that work their butts off, are conservative, don't say a word about it. And
absolutely,
I don't like looking at the industry when there are good people on both sides of the aisle that don't rock the boat, that get collectively crapped on.
But let's go back to the sexy part. You know, like the naked part.
That's why I do it.
I understand, I just think we should talk about that because that's where we went. Yeah. So here we are.
My buddy Laura Jansen, who she's talked to me about the evolution of men of movie stars, and she's used Sean Connery and Harrison Ford as an example of young and gorgeous. Both go through an awkward phase.
Yeah.
Harrison wore an earring at one time, and then eventually that phases out, and you become comfortable in your older gentleman, you know, refined gentleman of the whatever. Right. Ford is definitely in that. Ford is definitely in that aspect of this is who I am, and also the fact that he's got a sense of humor that hopefully people are aware of. Yes, he hates doing press conferences where there are dumb questions.
Makes him even more attractive.
Yes, but he'll go on Conan and straight face an argument with a Chewbacca in the audience. If you can't figure out he's kidding then, you know, I can't help you.
That when he did that, I laughed so hard. I was watching it and I'm on the floor.
Yeah.
Because it was just, you know, the thing about it is, because I hang out, I have a YouTube channel, so I hang out in this community. And a lot of people, when he got hurt on the set of Indiana Jones 5, one YouTuber attacked him for his age and started going after James Mangold, and it became a thing. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, Harrison Ford at the age of 79 can ride horses, rides a bicycle 30 miles, and plays tennis. And this guy is the guy that was complaining is a tub of lard. And I'm like, I'm jealous. I'm not popular because I see things objectively. I see things from the big picture, and people don't want to hear about it. They want their own little bubble. And conservatives who are mad at Hollywood, and all they see is, you know, Barbara Streisand and all that. And it's like,
so we only have 4 minutes, so let's get back to the sexy part. So, but
right,
I get it. I understand what you're saying, Stephanie.
Yeah.
And I'm in mourning. You know, I'm just chatting, you know.
Well,
but
let's
I
get
do
back to the sexy stuff. And
yeah,
talk
let's
about
get back
me
to the sexy. of course, Tommy. So anyway, since we only have 4 minutes, I'm thinking we just say, who is the one person in a movie that's so sexy to you that the movie could suck beyond belief, be in Portuguese, fuzzy, whatever, but you're watching it because of that actor? Matthew, you're first.
That's a loaded question, but very loaded question. But if I were a piano, I wish Michelle Pfeiffer would sing on it.
I knew you were going to say that. Good man.
Yeah, and my wife knows it.
I get it. Well, of course, and she's your love of your life. But we're talking movies. That's the way it goes. Stephanie, I shouldn't even ask, but who is it? Da 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 da.
Harrison Ford. The and he looked great at the Cannes Film Festival. He looked.
I thought so too.
I watched the whole walk up.
I bet you everybody did 85 great. Times. Mm-hmm.
But Kathleen Kennedy's dress, she got it at Target or TJ Maxx.
That would be Target.
Off the budget rack. Target. It was. I was like. No. Anyway.
So we have Han Solo. We have Harrison Hotboard. We've got beautiful Michelle Pfeiffer. Yeah. Tommy, who is your showstopper every time you're watching that damn movie because of the hottie?
It's been
a while, but Anne Margaret stole my heart along.
Oh, yeah.
Ago. Yeah.
I ran into her in Palm Springs 10 gorgeous years ago woman. Riding a Harley, and I thought, you go, girl.
Mm-hmm. Did you go vroom, vroom?
You know, I met her at the White House, and she's that was a while ago, but she was a gorgeous woman. I mean, she will always be gorgeous. I met Han Solo, too. I don't know if I told you that, Stephanie, at the White House. That was during his earring phase, but very sweet, sweet guy.
Yeah.
Bitching that about earring. His son not getting there, but or whatever. But
yeah.
Michelle Pfeiffer, I've not met, but she's a lovely lady. Yeah. Michael? I know, look, in respect to Heidi, but, you know, we're talking movies.
Yeah, I'm going to have to say Chewbacca.
Oh, shit.
Just kidding.
Way to represent the bear community.
Just kidding. Probably Jabba the Hutt. No.
Oh, ew. Gross. Maybe Carrie Fisher in that episode.
Oh, man. No, well, I don't.
I have the answer for you, Michael. This isn't hard. I mean, you put your damn beautiful, fabulous wife in your movie, so there you go.
Oh, hey, there we go. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Tom husband.
Yeah, there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, Paul Sorvino is mine, of course, and I always love Paul. But I'm just going to say, before Paul, my first crush was Christopher Reeve as Superman. So I love Henry Cavill. So I'm sort of partial to the Superman guys.
No,
did you hear that they knocked Cavill out? Cavill,
yes.
Sorry,
idiots.
Yeah, he's not.
Idiots.
James Gunn wanted to go a different way. I know. I agree.
I'm still waiting for somebody to top a Clark Kent performance. Everybody looks good in the blue suit, but I guess you have somebody with the suit and glasses that can top Mr. Reeve.
Nobody. It'll never happen. He is adorable as Clark Kent, but even more beautiful. I mean, seriously, I'm like a little kid, and I'm like, oh my God, that was my first crush. And it's just like, your first crush. I mean, you know, never goes away.
How many times have you watched Somewhere in Time?
Oh, many. Many. Mm-hmm. Many. And I've been to that hotel.
How jealous were you of Michael Caine in Death Trap?
Very. You know, and what do we, Tony, why do we have maybe 1 minute or no minute?
Yeah.
Probably no minute. Yeah, and you know what? 1 minute. So I'm glad you brought that up. I watched that the other night. And Paul met him, and it made it even more so when I told him, I said, well, you know, that was my first crush. And Paul just joked and said, well, it was my first crush. Meaning like he was such a beautiful man. And Paul knew him and talked to him. So he's a really smart, lovely man. And
the story is that him and Kane both went to Sidney Lumet, the director. They had they each had a bottle of brandy. And they said, you get one take.
I believe it. Michael Caine, I love him as an actor.
Yeah,
I mean, whatever. And Christopher Reeve is a scholar. I mean, he came from a family, I think, of scholars, actually. Yeah. So, anyway. Yeah. Well, I think we're out of time, folks. So, great show.
Let's do our toast.
Forget it back on. Yep, let's do the
Again?
Toast.
I'll get a picture of it.
Oh, yeah, we already did that, Tommy, remember?
Oh, okay. We'll use that one then.
All right. That's it. Bye, guys. Bye, guys. Love you. Bye. See ya.
You guys. Cheers. Take care.
Bye.
Cheers.
Cheers.